إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا Allahumma ameen, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this night beneficial for us, for our families and everybody. Ask Allah azza wa jal to show His blessings upon us and to be from His slaves and His servants, as-salihin, those ash-shakareen who are grateful and always thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His blessings in order to be from those of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continuously blesses them until the day of the judgment of Allah. We've been talking about the salat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, starting with the wudu, ghusl, the yamum and everything, purification that we need before we pray. And tonight we're going to go inshallah in details over the practical salat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is the sixth half of our sixth lecture. And we wanted to do it longer. We can do it longer because it has the details. But hopefully we're going to go over the most important things that we need in our salah in order that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with our salah. Because that's the most important thing. That the first thing, haqqullah, the first thing, the right of Allah that we're going to be asked on the day of the judgment is going to be our salah. If it's correct, then everything inshallah ta'ala will be correct after the aqidah, after the belief for sure. And if it's not correct, then everything else will not, or will depend on our salah. So we want that our salah be the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray it, in order to get the full reward and to strive hard in that, in order that Allah azza wa jal makes that salah a part of ourselves, makes that salah a part of our iman and our belief, to enjoy our salah. We don't want just to pray the salah automatically and to be just a random thing, but we want to enjoy our salah. We want to enjoy our private communication and speaking to our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we pray it in the way He loves it, as He taught the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we started or left last time, but when we started talking about the fara'id al-salah wa sunaniha, the arkan al-salah, the pillars of the salah, what is fard and pillar that need to be done in salah, and if you don't do it, then the salah is not considered valid, it's invalid. And we started with that the condition before, that's intention, we do the intention. We don't say it, but in our heart, there are intention for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't say anything else, because that is not narrated or from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, the first thing after the intention to start the salah is takbiratul ihram. And we mentioned that takbiratul ihram, sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that he used to raise his hands up to his shoulders, up to his ear lobes, up to his shoulders or up to his ear lobes without touching them. That's a hadith authentic from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and saying Allahu Akbar, and with this you enter in the salah. And we mentioned a mistake that many of our brothers and sisters do, especially when they want to reach the imam. Because they want to reach the imam is in the ruku', and then they say the takbir in a rush, very fast, and sometimes they don't say it while they are in a standing position, but they say it while they are going to the ruku'. He said the takbir to the ihram, the first takbirah, Allahu Akbar, should be said in the standing position. In the standing position. In the standing position, so when the imam is praying and you come and reach the salah, you say the takbir in a standing position calmly, and you're not only when you say, so you say Allahu Akbar, and Imam is in Rukua, the best is that you have to say another takbir, the takbir of the Imam when he said it for Rukua, because there are two takbir. The first takbir is the Rukun, the second one. So you said Allahu Akbar, the second takbir Allahu Akbar, then you go in the Rukua and you reach the Imam. Even if the Raka, I mean the Rukua, is gone, Alhamdulillah, you can do it. After that, you might do one Raka. But you say takbir while we're in standing position, while you are in the standing position. And we mentioned that we have three ways by saying the takbir and the raising the hands. You can say the takbir at the same time while you raise your hands, Allahu Akbar, at the same time while you raise your hands. You can say the takbir, Allahu Akbar, first, then you raise your hands. You say Allah.
Allahu Akbar.
Or you can raise your hands first, and then you say the takbir just slightly different time. And then, you can sit for myself. Then, after the takbir, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, Allahu Akbar, كَانَ يَضَعُ يَدَيْهِ عَلَى الصَّدْرِ. He used to put his right over his hand, and his right, left hand, and the wrist, palm of the wrist, the part of the arm, putting on the chest. That the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the chest is from starting, that there are narrations from above the belly button that starts up to the, what is called the chest. This part, what is called chest. So the Prophet ﷺ most of the time used to put in this way, or sometimes he used to grasp the whole hand in this way. So most of the times he used to put in this way without grasping, just leaving it loose, the hand, the right hand over the left, part of the palm, part of the wrist, and part of the arm. See? Or sometimes you used to grasp the whole hand, not with two fingers, but the whole hand, grasping the left with the right. As this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَكَانَ يَضَعُ يُمْنَا عَلَى ظَهْرِ كَفِّهِ الْيُسْرَ وَالرُّسْقِ وَالسَّاعِدِ. You can say it for now. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this hadith, قال إن معشر الأنبياء أمرنا بتعجيل فطرنا وتأخير سحورنا ووضع أيماننا على شمائلنا. هذا الحديث حديث صحيح من الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أخرجه الطيالسي وابن حبان وصححه. That he said صلى الله عليه وسلم, we the prophets, all the prophets, we have been commanded to eat or to break the fast right at the time of the Maghrib, ta'jeel, to hasten for breaking the fast, and to delay the eating of the suhoor up to the fajr, and to put our right hands over above the left hands. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَكَانَ يَضَعُهُمَا عَلَى الصَّبْرِ. Hadith is in Abu Dawood, rahimahullah, that he used to put right over the hand, over the left, on the chest. That's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are other different hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are different opinions of the scholars. Yes, we recognize that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all the scholars and all the madani that they have worked and in this occasions. But the most correct opinion, Allah knows best, Allahu alam, because of the hadith that are supporting it, that it is putting the hands on the chest, the right over the left. That's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We mentioned how you raise your hands, and then after putting the hands or the right over the left, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to open his salah after takbir by saying, reciting the dua or istiftah. Dua and istiftah, or the opening dua. That is highly recommended. If it is not, because the we are no Indian scholar that has it is wajib. So if you don't say, but we say that the best is the Prophet Sassan was never reported that he left it. Always sallallahu alayhi wa used to say the dua of istiftah. And that's the beauty of this, is that subhanAllah, when you reflect, you are at opening the salah with praising your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, that because you're gonna ask from him. So as people like go to the king or the president, they give some hadiah, some gifts first, and they want, I want this, I want that. So lillahi mathal ala, to Allah belongs the best of the examples and the parables, but we praise Allah as well first by saying these du'as and tasbihat in the beginning, then we ask what we want. And this is the case for the Fatiha too, subhanAllah, that's amazing. This is the case for the surah al-Fatiha. It's when you recite the salah, how it is constructed, from the du'as and everything, you really are amazed at how beautifully Allah Azza wa Jalla has legislated for us this salah in order to enjoy it. But there are beautiful wisdoms and meanings, deep meanings behind every harakah, every movement, and any du'a, and any and every word that you say. There are wisdoms and deep meanings behind that. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to say this du'a, especially in Salat al-Fajr. What we know, most of us, at least we know, Subhanakallah, that's the easiest. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in Fajr, especially the Fajr, that is, has come narrated from Ibn Bukhari and Muslim, is the du'a, beautiful du'a of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to say, Allahumma ba'id bayni khataya, bayni wa bayna khatayaya, kama ba'adda bayna al-mashriqi wal-maghrib, اللهم نقني من خطاياي كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس اللهم اغسلني من خطاياي بالماء والثلج والبرد. وكان يقولها في الفرض, as we said, in صلاه الفرض فرائض. He used to say this beautiful dua, oh Allah, make a distance between me and my sins, like you make a distance between the east and the west. Oh Allah, cleanse me from my sins, or clean from my sins, like a white cloth is being cleaned from the filth. Allahumma ghsilni, O Allah, wash my sins with water, with hail, and with water, with snow and hail or ice. And this is a beautiful dua of the Prophet ﷺ that he used to say before starting the beginning of the salah. Other du'as that the Prophet used to use them, that's what we start, many of us, or some of us, you know, wajah to wajah, bidadi fatar as-salawati wa al-fatar hanifa, a long du'a. You can read it, and you can get it, inshallah, in books, Hasan al-Muslim, the app, even apps, and the phones, smartphones, you can get it. And the du'a that we know, subhanakallah, alhamdi, wa tabarak asmuk, wa ta'ala jadduk, ولا إله غيرك. Short du'a, the Prophet used to do it. Or Allahu Akbar Kabira, والحمد لله كثيرا, وسبحان الله بكرة وأصيلا. Even that's the beginning. You can say a person استفتح رجل به, رجل من الصحابة, one of the Sahaba, he said this du'a. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet said, عجبت لها فتحت لها أبواب السماء. I am amazed for this dua. The gates, the doors of the heaven are open, meaning that their dua is going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will accept it. Mm-hmm. The doors of the heaven are open for this dua. Very short dua. Allahu Akbar kabira, wa alhamdulillahi kathira, wa subhanallahi bukratan wa asila. Then the other dua that we're talking about, dua istiftah, opening dua. Alhamdulillahi hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fi. A person from the Sahaba, he said that. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لقد رأيت 12 ملكا يبتدرونها أيهم يرفعها. I have seen 12 angels. They are competing, whoever takes this dua, to raise it up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hadith sahih from the Prophet in sahih Muslim. So many of these duas, you can, and from the Sunnah of the Prophet, sometimes you can do one, sometimes the other one. So in order that your salah doesn't become a routine. Because even if you know something, you know, you do always, we don't think, especially the meaning, we don't ponder on the meanings, it becomes a routine. But when you change, sometimes this, sometimes that dua, and you really contemplate and ponder in the meanings, you really will enjoy your salah. You really will enjoy salah, as you do for your food. Now you don't eat the same, every time the same food. Even if it's the best of the food, it becomes a routine for you. That's how we change. Sometimes you put some desserts, sometimes you put some fruits here and there. You change your meals. So the salah should be the same, should be actually the better than that. That's a dua or an istiftah. Other dua, I just mentioned some of these duas. We have more than 9 of those. The Prophet used to use it. Then after salat, after dua or istiftah, the Prophet used to say al-isti'adah, seeking refuge with Allah Azza wa Jal from the shaytan al-rajim, based on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. When you are going to read the Qur'an, seek refuge with Allah from the shaytan al-rajim. Seek refuge with Allah from the shaytan al-rajim. And this, the most correct opinion is that should be said at every rak'ah, not only the first rak'ah. At every rak'ah, as long as you recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Usually you know the Surah Al-Fatiha is a rukn, a pillar for the salah, each rak'ah, every rak'ah. As long as you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, you should recite Al-Isti'adha, so meaning you should seek refuge with Allah Azza wa Jal from the Shaytan al-Rajim at every rak'ah before Surah Al-Fatiha. Because this ayah is general. This ayah is comprehensive. For any time you recite the Qur'an, you open the Qur'an, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And there is no proof or evidence that says us we need to recite only the first rak'ah, that's it. There is no proof that the Prophet ﷺ used to use that only the first rak'ah. And how do we say the best? There are 3 types of asking or seeking refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The longest, medium, and the short. The shortest one is that we say A'udhu billahi min shaytan rajim, that many everybody knows. The other two are A'udhu billahi min shaytan rajim min hamzihi wa nafthihi wa nafthihi. The longest one we add أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفخه. This is the best. So you can use sometimes this, sometimes that. All these 3 are from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, authentic sunnah. How should we say this? Should we raise our voices by saying it? No. We should say it in ourselves. There is no authentic report of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say it loudly. The isti'adha by saying A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajim before Surah Al-Fatiha, he would not use to say it loudly but hidden in yourself. Say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajim as you said before the other 2 types of isti'adha. As we're going, that we are praying, as we said, the qiyam or standing up for the person who can, he is able to do so, it is a pillar of the salah. It is a pillar of the salah, meaning that the person who can stand and does not stand up while he's praying, his salah is void. He has to repeat his salah, standing up. Because standing up, al-qiyam wajib or fariḍa, it is a pillar. Because the Prophet in Hadith Imran al-Husayn, he said, صَلِّي قَائِمًا, pray standing up, while standing up. فَلَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ, if you cannot, then qaidan, then sitting down. And if you cannot, then alajan, then laying down. On the person, if you can, not. But if you can, you have to pray standing up. Unless the person, as you said, is sick and he cannot. Unless the person, even with a sickness, he cannot stand up, but it is laying down, he can pray laying down. And he cannot move, he can pray Allah and stay easy to the salah, even with your eyes. He cannot move anything, even with only pointing, you know, with the eyes, like signals. That will only the eyes, you can pray your salah at any position. And that tells us for the importance of the salah. Because it's the only wajib, it's the only mandatory, that the thing that Allah has asked us to do, and you can do it at his. There is rulings to do it at any situation that you are, at any situation that you are in this worldly life. So this we're talking about Salatul Sunnah, Salatul Fard. But Salatul Sunnah, the person is sick, or even he's not sick, he's tired, or I think he can pray while he's sitting down. He can pray while sitting, but if you can pray standing up, and you just choose to pray sitting down, the reward is half. The reward is half. Not for the person who is sick. Who is sick, inshallah ta'ala, he gets the same reward as the one, because he has an excuse for that. But the one who doesn't have an excuse, and maybe he's a little bit tired or whatever, he also prays Salatul Sunnah, and to do the Sunnah as the Prophet sometimes used to pray, sitting down. So Salatul Sunnah, nothing. Voluntary prayers, he can pray it like sitting down, and without any excuse, he gets how much? Gets the half of the reward of the Salah if he used to pray, if he was to pray it by standing up. Then after an isti'adah, by seeking refuge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan rajim, the Prophet used to start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and Basmala. And Basmala, the most correct opinion is that it is an ayah from Surah Al-Fatiha. It is an ayah from Surah Al-Fatiha. But there is a different opinions of the scholars. Do we say it loudly, or we say it in ourselves? And after going over the adillas or the evidences for that, there is no hadith sahih, authentic, sahih. Like right away, the Prophet has a very explicit hadith to tell that the Prophet used to say the basmala jahran, loud. But actually, there are a hadith that from Anas, especially from Anas radiallahu anhu, that he said, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبا بكر وعمر رضي الله عنهما كانوا يفتتحون الصلاة بالحمد لله رب العالمين. Meaning that they did not hear the Prophet saying it loudly. Because he said, Anas radiallahu anhu, the Prophet and Abu Bakr in his khilaf, and Umar radiallahu anhu, they used to start their salah by Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, meaning that they did not hear them to recite Bismillah Rahman Rahim. That doesn't mean that they didn't recite, but that they recited in themselves. They didn't recite. So the hadith of the Prophet, especially on the Khulafa al-Rashidin, they tell us that they didn't pray one day, they prayed every day, they prayed every salah. They tell us that it is sunnah to recite in yourself, just to hear yourself with it and not say it loudly. Sometimes, but there is no hadith of the Prophet from that, but some of the Sahaba, yes, some of the Sahaba, they used to recite it loudly, sometimes, not always, they used to recite Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim loudly. This is the madhhab al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, that they say it always loudly. As we said, but Allah knows best, the most correct opinion of Rajih is that you say it in yourself. Then the first, when you recite loudly, especially for the Imam we're talking, or you're praying by yourself, you recite with Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, with Surat Al-Fatiha. With Surat Al-Fatiha. As we said, but Bismillah Rahman Rahim is an ayah from the Fatiha, but you don't recite loudly. Maybe once in a while, just because of some of the Sahaba, they did it, and maybe they heard the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but there is no authentic and explicit hadith narrating that. And Surah Al-Fatiha, it is, as we said, it is a rukn. Whoever doesn't recite Surah Al-Fatiha for the person, for the Imam and the person, or the ma'mum, the one who's praying behind the Imam. Surah Al-Fatiha is a pillar, is a rukn, and should be recited. Without reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, the salah is void, unless the person has just entered Islam, he doesn't know anything else, or just know some ayahs from the Quran, whatever, this is an exception. But usually, if you know Surah Al-Fatiha, that should be recited in the Quran. And that actually, for the person who doesn't know Surah Al-Fatiha, you just entered Islam and doesn't know, he doesn't know anything from Quran, even just from Surah Al-Fatiha. What does he say? فَلْيَقُلْ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ وَلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ وَلَا حَوْلَ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And the person, new Muslim, he doesn't know anything from the Quran, let's say this dua. And no Fatiha, nothing, let's say this dua. because that came from a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. جَاءَ رَجُلٌ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. A person came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَقَالَ, he said, إِنِّي لَأَسْتَطِيعُ أَنْ أَخُذَ شَيْئًا مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ فَعَلِّمْنِي مَا يُجْزِئُنِي. Said, I cannot memorize anything from the Quran. Not new Muslim nowadays, but he said, I cannot memorize anything. This is my mind. I cannot memorize anything. So teach me, Ya Rasulullah, something that will suffice me for my salah. فَقَالَ قُلْ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, say, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Hadith in Sahih Abu Dawud. And another hadith, he said, فَقَالَ إِن كَانَ مَعَكَ قُرْآنُ فَقَرَ وَإِلَّا فَأَحْمَدْهُ وَكَبِّرْهُ وَهَلِّهُ ثُمَّ رَكَعَ. He said to one person, if you know any, memorize any Quran, read. Otherwise, then you make tahmid, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make tahmid to him, وَهَلِّلُوا لَحَا وَذَا قُلْتِدَا وَتَهْلَا لَا إِلَى اللَّهِ, and then you make ruku to Allah azza wa ta'ala. Is reciting Surat al-Fatiha. Is it allowed for us to recite Surat al-Fatiha while the Imam is reciting? No, when the Imam is reciting, it's not allowed for us to recite with the Imam at the same time, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is prohibited from that. And we know the ayah in the Quran, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. When the Quran is being recited, فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ, listen attentively and pay attention. وَأَنصِتُوا, calmly and be quiet, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ, in order that you'll get the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the mercy of Allah azza wa ta'ala. So they have said, especially for Surah Al-Fatiha, so what the Imam is reciting, we should not recite anything else. Even so, if the Imam gives you time to recite, alhamdulillah. But if even it's not here in this case that the Imam is reciting loudly, we're talking in Salat al-Jahri, loudly. But when the Imam is praying the Salat al-Dhuhr, Salat al-Asr, and you are praying behind the Imam, you have to recite Surah al-Fatiha. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said hadith, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There is no salah. There is no valid salah for the one who doesn't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. So, when the Imam is not reciting loudly, you should recite Surah Al-Fatiha by yourself, because it's a pillar, it's a rukn from the salah. Then, after reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, and actually, you have to contemplate Surah Al-Fatiha, that's because it's really that private conversation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the hadith Qudsi, and then Allah azza wa said, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي إِلَى نِصْفَيْنِ. I have divided the salah, meaning Surah Al-Fatiha here in the hadith, between me and my servant in two parts. When he says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah Azza wa Jal says, Hamadani Abdi, my slave or my servant, has thanked me. And when he says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah Azza wa Jal says, Majdani Abdi, my slave has glorified me. And then, or Athna Alayhi Abdi. And when he says, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Athna alayya wa majdani abdi," my servant has overpraised me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it came to the hadith that one really, when he said, this is between me and my slave, or we say, "Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in, ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim." This is the dua that we ask. What do we ask in Surah Al-Fatiha? To guide us and to keep us in the right path. This is the best dua ever that has in it everything you need for this world of life and the hereafter. That's why this dua, at least you say it during the day and the night 17 times. You're asking Allah Azza wa Jalla to keep you in the right path 17 times. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said, this is from my slave. And wali abdi ma sa'al. And for the slave, for my servant, is whatever he wants. Whatever he wants, I will give him. Then, and that is the description of the Sirat al-Mustaqim, this guidance, that this is Sirat al-Mustaqim, the path, the righteous path and the right path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he used to do was that at the end of the surah al-Fatiha, used to say the ta'meen, the ameen, loudly. He used to say the ameen loudly. كان صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا انتهى من قراءة الفاتحة قال آمين يجهر ويمد بها صوتا صلى الله عليه وسلم حديث صحيح بخاري. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used when he used to finish the surah al-Fatiha to say آمين يجهر. He used to say it loudly and prolonging or stretching the voice by saying آمين. So used to say by himself, and the jama'ah, the same thing they used to say with the imam, with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And here is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we have to say it after the imam, right away after the imam, meaning that with the imam, because what the imam said, even the angels, they say it at the same time. And when you do that, Allah will forgive your previous sins. That's a great reward. But as we have mentioned many times, here in this case is the only time when the imam becomes ma'mum, and the ma'mumin become like the imam, because they say it before the imam. That's the problem. So instead of saying the imam should start it, the people, they just wait, the imam say walabbalin, and they start saying ameen. That's a mistake. We should wait. You hear from the imam starting with hamza, then you say walabbalin. You start ameen, then you say ameen, in order that you want to get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا قَالَ الْإِمَامُ غَيْرُ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ فَقُولُوا آمِينَ فَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَقُولُ آمِينَ وَإِنَّ الْإِمَامَ يَقُولُ آمِينَ وَفِي لَفْظٍ إِذَا أَمَّنَ الْإِمَامُ فَأَمِّنُوا. When the imam says آمِينَ فَأَمِّنُوا, right away, immediately after the imam, not before imam. فَمَنْ وَافَقَ تَأْمِينُهُ تَأْمِينَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ فِي السَّمَاءِ, they say آمِينَ فَغُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whoever says in the same time with the angels that pray in the same time only while we pray, not that. Well, the jama'ah, the first jama'ah, they pray. Whoever his coincides in the same time with the malaika, غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ, his sins, his previous sins will be forgiven to him. This is regarded as ameen. As we said, while you are praying the salawat, as-sirriya, duhur al-asr, you should say even surat al-fatiha. As fatiha is rukn. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to recite another surah after surat al-fatiha. That surah is not wajib, is not mandatory, or is not a filler as for the fatiha, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to recite it, and sometimes used to recite long, sometimes short, especially when he was traveling or sick, or he listened to the mother that has a child that is crying or has something. The Prophet used to make it shorter because بُوِثَ صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة للعالمين, he was sent as a mercy for all worlds and all mankind صلى الله عليه وسلم, even the animals صلى الله عليه وسلم. كما قال أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه جوز ذات يوم في الفجر صلى الصبح فقرأ بأقصر سورتين في القرآن فقيل يا رسول الله لما جوز؟ قال سمعت بكاء صبي فظننت أن أمه معنا تصلي فأردت أن أفرغ له صلى الله على نبينا محمد وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. We have not sent you as but as a rahmah for the alameen. نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, the most beloved to us. One day Anas ibn Malik was on the range that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he recited very shortly in Fajr, Salah Fajr. Usually he used to recite long, and he recited with the two shortest surah from the Quran. That's the recital. So Anas or the Sahaba, they said to him, Ya Rasulullah, I mean, what happened today? Why you made it so short? And he said, sallallahu, I heard a child crying, and I thought that maybe His mother is with us praying, so I wanted to make the mother to take care of the child. That's why I made it shorter. Sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. And كان يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم تعطى كل سورة حظها من الركوع والسجود تعطى كل سورة حظها من الركوع والسجود يعني meaning that give every surah that's its حق from the ركوع and the سجود meaning that you use or you recite any surah like sometimes long sometimes short and it depends how you recite but he used to recite in the first rakah, longer than the second rakah. The first rakah used to make it longer than the first, than the second rakah. And it is from the sunnah of the Prophet. Usually, in the third rakah and the fourth rakah, we recite only Surah Al-Fatiha. But ahyanan, sometimes the Prophet used to add surahs, used to recite surahs that you recite in the first and second rakah. So he did not always used to recite only Surah Al-Fatiha, the third rakah and the fourth. But sometimes he used to add some other surahs as he used to do it in the first or the second. This is from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just briefly, what was his Sunnah, for example, to recite in Salat al-Fajr? Used to recite Surah Al-Tur, sometimes used to recite Surah Al-Qaf. In the first rakah, used to recite the Shamsu Kuirat, Surah Al-Takwir, Surah Al-Zalzala, Surah Al-Fajr. Sure. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes when he used to recite Kul A'udhu Birabbil Falaq, Kul A'udhu Birabbil Nas, Fajr. When he was a traveler. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All these are authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And sometimes used to recite Surah Al-Rum, and sometimes Surah Yaseen, and longer than that. Sometimes used to recite Surah Al-Saffat. Sometimes Surah Al-Sajda as the Jum'ah and Hal Ata ala al-Insan, Surah Al-Insan. In Salat al-Dhuhr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to recite in each of two rakahs Qadra 30 ayah, and almost 30 ayahs in each rakah. So almost 30 ayahs is Surah Al-Sajda, and in three pages, only one rakah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the second rakas, I'm sorry, the two other two rakas, the third and the fourth, you should say half of it. Half of it, like this surah, like 15 ayahs or so. Sometimes you used to recite surah Was-Sama'i Wa-Tariq, Was-Sama'i Dhati Al-Buruj, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Is-Sama'i Wa-Shaqat, these all surahs. In Salat Al-Asr, you used to recite half of Salat Al-Dhuhr, like the prolongation of the Salat. Salat Al-Maghrib, كان يقرأ بقصار مفصل سورة sometimes long and sometimes short والتين والزيتون for example sometimes okay sometimes he used to recite even with longer surahs he used to recite سورة الطول in يعني two pages and a half in صلاة المغرب والمرسلات and sometimes صلى الله عليه وسلم used to recite سورة الأعراف يعني سورة الأعراف in two rakats because the second third rakah you recite a long surah in Salat al-Maghrib. If you recite Surah al-A'raf in Salat al-Maghrib, next day nobody's gonna come to Maghrib. So actually, it's the opposite. Salat al-Isha, the Prophet used to make it short. Salat al-Maghrib to make it long. And we do the opposite actually. So Salat al-Isha, people, especially they think that it should be longer. No, that's easy for the people. So that maybe they want to go to rest, home, and things, or can pray. Whatever that's used to recite, shorter for Salat al-Isha. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like for example, in the Surah al-Shams wa Duha, that's probably used to recite Salat al-Or in the Sama' al-Shaqqa. Or Tini wa Zaytun in Salat al-Isha. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ayah, ayah. So he used to stop at every ayah. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين اياك نعبد واياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين انعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين امين. That's Imam Farrar, as they used to say. Or they, you have on YouTube if you can see. Especially for Tawil. So, because subhanAllah, you have to contemplate, especially Surah Al-Fatiha. And when you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, after each ayah, you wait, as we mentioned the hadith, you wait for the response of Allah. Yeah, you can say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Hamadani Abdu. Allah is saying, Hamadani Abdu. You wait. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. You wait, Allah Azza wa Jalla is talking to you. He's saying, Majdani Abdu wa Rahmatna Alayhi Abdu. Yeah, this is the way. Or, this is for Surah Al-Fatiha, but for the other surahs too, the Prophet used to stop at each and every ayah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thumma yaqif at each ayah. وكان صلى الله عليه وسلم يقرأ ويمد القراءة يوسف اللهم القراءة نور تجويد and ترتيب صلى الله عليه وسلم beautifying the voice because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said كان يرتل القرآن ترتيلا he used to recite the Quran with ترتيل and تجويد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Another thing we can benefit, like for example, some people they know that one the ayah, أليس ذلك بقادر على أن يحيي الموتى, or سبح اسم ربك الأعلى, that it is مستحب when we read this ayah, أليس ذلك بقادر على أن يحيي الموتى, which surah? قيامة. Surah القيامة. It is مستحب. To that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he used to recite this, said, قال سبحان ربي الأعلى. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, سبحان ربي الأعلى. That, and أليس ذلك بقادر على أن يحيي الموتى؟ قال سبحانك فبلى. سبحانك فبلى. Because the ayah meaning is not Allah Azza wa Jal بقادر. It is not, he is not him able to resurrect the dead, and the Prophet responded, like it's an answer, and a question. The Prophet responded by saying, Subhanak, glorified be you, Bala, Bala. Indeed, yes, Allah Azza wa Jalla is able to resurrect the dead. This is narrated from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you can say, Subhanak, Bala. Then it comes the term for takbirat al-intiqal. Yani the other takbirat other than the first takbir of the opening takbir. Takbirat al-ihram. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قام إلى الصلاة يكبر حين يقوم ثم يكبر حين يركع ثم يقول سمع الله لمن حمده حين يرفع صلبه من ركعة ثم يقول وهو قائم ربنا لك الحمد ثم يكبر حين يهوي. So the hadith of the Prophet as you said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي صَلِّي pray as you see me pray. So he used to make the takbirat al-intiqal. But the takbirat al-intiqal means the movement that you do, and going to the ruku' and going to the sujood, or between two sajdas, or going to the other rak'ah. The Prophet used to do that. This is not considered as the first, that it's not a pillar of salah. So you forgot it. That you do set for forgetfulness, but you don't have to repeat and go back and repeat. But if you forget a rukun, a pillar, like you forget to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, you have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, or otherwise that rak'ah is not considered. You don't count that rak'ah, you have to bring another rak'ah. Then, as brother was explaining to us, Prophet used to go in the ruku, how we go in the ruku. Used to make the takbir and going in the ruku. What ruku? What tuma'nina tu fi. So go in the ruku, ruku is the other ruku, the pillar. Allahu Akbar. Raising the hands, up to the shoulders or up to the earlobes and going to the ruku'ah. And the ruku'ah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you should stay calmly, and that every single thing, bone should go in its place and the back should be straight. This is the ruku'ah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us how to do it. And the hands should be spread on the knees, grasping the knees. You're looking to the place of your sujood. And as we said, even the head should be in the same position as straight with the back. As they used to say, if you spill some water, the water doesn't go down but stays on the back. Or even if you put the cup of the water, doesn't fall down.
90 degrees.
Yes. So a mistake is that you don't go down. That's a mistake. The ruku'ah is not completed. Or if you don't do it right, so many people they do it. We're talking about people who are able. The one who is sick, alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure and heal him.
Yes. Why do we have to keep our eyes on the
in the place of the center? But the place of the center doesn't mean that it's only just that's it, the other place. The place of the center is everything that starts from your feet and there. It's okay. Even if you look at the feet, some say you can look at the feet, but you look at the place of the center, that's it. And in the ruku, the Prophet ﷺ used to stay calmly and making the adhkar of the ruku by saying, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. That's the easiest thing that we know. Wait, there. Or you can sit. As we mentioned, it's very important that the back should be straight. It's very important that especially the back, because the Prophet saw a person that he didn't pray right, musik salat, and he said, go and pray. Why? Because he didn't pray. So if the person doesn't complete his ruku, and the ruku is what? Is a rukun, is a pillar. His salat is invalid. And we don't want our salat to be invalid. The back should be straight, as said, and the hand spread on the knees. But the most important thing, that's the sunnah of the Prophet. But the most important thing, that's the rukun, the ruku'ah, the back should be straight, and look at the position of the sajda where we are looking. That's the most important thing. Because in another hadith, the Prophet said, the worst of the thieves is the one who steals from his salah. Said, yes. La yutimmu ruku'ahu wa la sujood. He is the one who doesn't complete, doesn't perfect the ruku' and sujood. So he does it, as we said, with his back up or his back bowing too much, and doesn't do it right in the position of ruku'. From the adhkar of ruku', we, as we mentioned, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, that's the from the adhkar, we say it three times. Sunnah is to say it three times, but one is sufficient, like the wajib. Mandatory is one. Doesn't mean now I would say Alhamdulillah is the time to say, we can say 3, 4, 5, 9, 8. It's better to say it in an odd number. Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, then, or sometimes Subhana Rabbi al-Azim wa bihamdi, adding wa bihamdi. Sometimes Subbuhun Quddusun Rabbul Malaikati wa Ruhi, you can say it many times. Not more than once. Or Subhanaka Allahumma Rabbana wa bihamdik Allahumma ighfirli. These are all authentic du'as the Prophet used to use and to say it in ruku'ah. Allahumma laka raka'at wa bika amant wa laka aslamt anta rabbi khasha'a laka sabri wa basari wa mukhi wa awmi wa asabi وَمَا اسْتَقَلَّتْ بِهِ قَدَمِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. These are all du'as of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Seven du'as. سُبْحَانَ ذِي الْجَبَرُوتِ وَالْمَلَكُوتِ وَالْكِبْرِيَاءِ وَالْعَظَمَةِ. These are all du'as of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم that you use to change. Sometimes you do this, sometimes you try to memorize more, because your salah will not become a routine. Try to memorize from all these du'as. Sometimes you use this one, and sometimes other ones. It is not allowed, haram, to recite Quran in the ruku'ah. It is not allowed to recite Quran in the ruku'ah. The Prophet prohibited. قَالَ أَلَا وَإِنِّي مُهِيتُ أَنْ أَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ رَاكِعًا أَوْ سَاجِدًا. Indeed, I have been prohibited to recite Quran while I'm in ruku' or I'm doing in the sajda. أَمَّا الرُّكُوعَ فَعَظِّمُ فِيهِ رَبَّ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. What's the right thing in the ruku' to do is what? عَظِّمُ Allah Azza, to magnify, to revere Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. وَأَمَّا السُّجُودُ فَاجْتَهِدُوا فِي الدُّعَاءِ. Or in the sajda, you strive to make a lot of du'as, a lot of du'as. فَقَمِينٌ أَنْ يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. So it's more like that will be responded to you in the du'a, because you are closest to Allah Azza wa Jalla, as we know in the hadith of the Prophet in the sujood. And then from the ruku', the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi another ruku' that goes to the position of standing up as he were before. By saying, after saying Sami Allahu liman hamid. ربنا ولك الحمد. That's what you used to know, at least. So the same, and here we have to do the same, but raising your back up and in the standing position, so as every bone goes to its place calmly, and the rest, because doing that, being quietly and calmly, it's a rukun in itself. So, and each and every bone goes to itself. A mistake done by the people, they say Sami Allahu liman hamid, and before they straighten their back, right away, like a rocket, they go in the sajda. And that's a mistake. The Prophet used to do it slowly and calmly. So that's right away by going, they don't raise their back, they don't straighten their back, and they go immediately to the sajda. And that was not the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You have to stay. The Prophet used to say to stay longer here. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam كما قال عائشة رضي الله عنها كان صلاة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سواء. It was almost the same, meaning starting from recitation of the Quran, so the Prophet of the Quran, and then the ruku', just a little bit less than the recitation, and then raising your back from the ruku', just a little bit less than the ruku', then the sajda, just a little bit less than raising your back. So it was the salat of the Prophet قريبا من السواب كما قال عائشة رضي الله عنها. That was almost the same, like that. All different positions, they have almost the same length, almost. So you stay, like if you stay in ruku' 1 minute or 2 minutes, we don't say no more than 2 minutes, but the Prophet used to say it more than that. If you stay 2 minutes in ruku', then raising your back, so it could be 1 minute, 1 minute and a half, almost the same. And then, as the Prophet said, Sami Allahu liman hamida, Allah listens and hears the one who praises him. And then, Rabbana lakal hamd. Or, Rabbana wa lakal hamd. Rabbana wa lakal hamd. Hamdan kathiran, tayyiban, mubarakan fi, mubarakan alayhi, kama yuhibbu Rabbuna. All these are du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes we used to add. مِلْ أَسَّمَاوَاتِ وَمِنْ أَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا وَمِنْ أَنْعَشِدْنَ مَنْ شَيْءٍ بَعْدِ. Many du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say while he was standing up. So, in order to say these du'as, you have need some time. In order to say these du'as, you contemplate, you need some time. That's why you rest and you contemplate what are you saying. And the most correct opinion is that even the ma'mumin, when you pray with the imam, you say Sami Allahu liman hamd. Not only the imam says Sami Allahu liman hamd, I hear some brothers right away, they say Rabbana wa lakal hamd. Say it, even you. And you say the imam is saying Sami Allahu liman hamd, you with the praying the imam, say Sami Allahu liman hamd. Repeat what the imam is saying. Do not only say, yani, there are different opinions, but this is Allah knows best, most correct opinion, there are a hadith for that, that you repeat what the imam is saying. By saying, Sami Allahu liman hamida, even if you pray with the imam, then you say, Rabbana wa lakal hamd, whatever the imam is saying. Then, the other rukun that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yahwi ila sujood, coming to the
center.
So by after finishing this class, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is two different opinions between the scholars here. As you say, but we go with the rajih, the most correct opinion according to the authentic proofs that we believe are the authentic evidences for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he used to go to the sajda by putting the hands first and not the knees first. And we'll say why. By putting the hands first and not the knees first, by saying, we'll demonstrate first and then we say. So by saying Takbir, Allahu Akbar. Now, raising the hands, we did it when we said Sami Allahu Alaihi Muhammadan. So most of the times the Prophet went, while he goes to the sajda, from the standing up to the sajda, he used not to raise his hands, most of the times. Sometimes he used to do it, but generally speaking, no. So because we raised our hands when we said Sami Allahu Alaihi Muhammadan. So here we go to the sujood by putting his hands first, opening his hands first, and putting the first on the ground, then the knees touching the ground, saying Allahu Akbar, yes.
Allahu Akbar.
And the hands should be put like the takbir, straight in the position, facing the qibla, facing the Kaaba, the same position that we did up to the shoulders or up to the earlobes. So it is up to the shoulders, there on the ground, or up to the earlobes. We'll make sure in the position of sajda. You're going to turn, brother, after that. Make sure in the position of sajda that seven bones are touching the ground, because that's mandatory. Seven bones are touching the ground. The forehead plus the nose. Many people, they do a mistake because they just put the forehead and the nose is up. Nose is a part of the forehead. All, one. And two palms, two knees, and the toes. All they should have to touch the ground. You can turn around. No, this one. Like a break. So,
Allahu Akbar. We can make the video. This one could be good.
Yeah, once like this and once like this. So I mean to see the feet, because then. So the feet and the Prophet used to touch the feet together. If you don't touch the feet, your salah is still valid. We don't say that it's not valid. But I mean, we're trying to get to the point, as the Prophet used to pray, what is sunnah? Sometimes we to perform it, to perfect it. And that's why we're trying to learn the salah of the Prophet. So sometimes some people may do a mistake, they raise their feet while they are in sujood, like this. Or the intertwine between the feet, the two feet. Sometimes, and they raise it. Okay? As we said, at least the time that you say Subhanallah al-A'la once, these parts should touch the ground, at least. Otherwise, yours. Or a sajda is not considered a sajda, so that's a rukun, so you have to redo it. Jazakallah khair. So, yeah, well, I just mentioned that. So, as we said, there are two opinions of the scholars. By going in the sujood with the knees first, or going with the hands first. We said the most correct opinions, according to the evidences, Allah knows best, as we said, is going with the knee, with the hands first. Why is that? Because the Prophet, there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he prohibited by going to the sujood like kama yabruqul ba'ir, like the camel goes down. And the camel, the Arabs, they know that how a camel lands, it lands by putting its knees first. The camel lands by putting its knees first. Because the camel, like, doesn't have hands, but the first thing that's considered like hands, he goes by putting the knees like this, the two legs, the legs it puts first the knees, and then it puts the two hands, that's considered the two hands, like for the animal, the after that. So the Prophet is prohibited from that. And there are some things that can help us to understand that why, or the Prophet said to put the hands first or not. Because it was for the Sunnah of the Prophet at Tajafi. What's the Tajafi? To open his hands. And if you are putting your hand, your knees first, why you need to open your hands when you go in the sajda? Doesn't make sense. And why you need to open your hands if you want to go to sajda? You want to go with the knees first. You don't need to open your hand. Just go like that. Is that true? But if you want to go in the sajda, and by putting the hands first, you need to open up your hands. Allahu Akbar. Okay, so the sunnah of the Prophet was of tajafi. Tajafi means that he used to open up his hands a lot, especially when you are praying by yourself. When you are praying the jama'ah, you don't want to bother the brother next to you. But that's what the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then another thing that can help, like common sense, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they didn't have carpets. They used to pray on the ground, pebbles and things. What is easier, especially for an aged person, old and senior, what is easier? To go with the knees first or to go with the hands first? Go with the hands first. That's easy, especially for the talking for. We're not talking about the young people, so they can live there and that. So Lisa, but the main thing is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that he prohibited to go in sajda as the ba'ir or the camel lands in the sajda. So the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is to go with the hands first. Allahu a'lam, Allah knows best. And he said that the sajda, the Prophet ﷺ used to say the dua Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, that's the least, as we said, is once, but you say it three times. That's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the sajda, some people, they do some mistakes, especially when they put, you can demonstrate, they put the hands closer to the thighs and touching the thighs. Touching the thighs.
Touching
the thighs.
The ground.
Yeah, no, the ground is another thing. That's touching. Yeah. Touching the thighs, one. Or putting on the grounds like the dogs. Yeah. In the ground, yes.
Yeah.
That is prohibited from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because it's the way the dog sits on the ground. So that actually should be taken care of, so not to do that in the sujood. And the du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the sujood could be the same that he said, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, and we add, wa bihamdi, subbuhu kuddusum, rabbul malaikati wa ruh, subhanakallahu rabbana, wa bihamdi, Allahumma fili, that's what he mentioned. Many other du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you can do any other du'a because the sujood is the place when you are closer to your Lord, subhanallah, fa'akthir al-du'a. كما قال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه السجود فأكثر الدعاء the closest place when Allah the person is or the servant of Allah is with Allah is in sajda, so make a lot of dua. And as we said, it's not allowed to recite Quran. What about some of the du'as that come from the Quran? The question comes. This, in general speaking, we say Quran. But this dua in this place is considered as a dua. General dua, so you can do the dua because it's a general dua. This place is an exception and is considered as dua, so you can do that dua in the sujood. Then, after that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because we have two sajdas to complete the first, to complete one rak'ah. Demonstrated, he used to raise his head. That's a rukn, a pillar, to raise his head in the other way. First, or yes, you can do that. After finishing the sajda, Allahu Akbar, takbir, and that's the jalsa between the two sajdas, sitting in between the two sessions. You can turn how the Prophet this way to see the feet. Yes. Used to sit on the left and keeping the right foot erecting like this. And used to say in between two sessions at least Rabbi Ghafirli twice or thrice, or other du'as, Rabbi Ghafirli wa rahmni wa jibni wa afini wa rzuqni, other du'as that we should memorize it in order to say that in order to, for Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive our sins. And that was the adhkar between sins. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go again in the sajda. And another way the Prophet used to sit in between two sajdas is, this is called al-iq'a. No, between two sajdas. Al-iq'a, that you sit. Yes. This is the iq'a, that is allowed, in between two sajdas. The first position is that you sit on the left and you keep the right erected. Or this position, that you sit on the heels of the feet, and then you go back to the sajda and you do the same as you did before. The Salah is coming, it's only 5 minutes. Hopefully, the brother Ashraf is not here, we can continue just a little bit after Isha. But if he is here, maybe we'll need another. Okay, because there is no time for that.
Is it possible to complete today?
I can do it after Isha. Subhanakallah, because only 5 minutes, we can call the Adhan and they come. Do you hear the din? Everybody is on it. May Allah reward the brothers that we have forgiven that after we finish the lecture, inshallah, regarding the salah. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ونكمل إن شاء الله. We were at the position of the sajda, or between the two sajdas and the other sajda, as we said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. With that, the second sajda, we complete the one rak'ah. We complete one rak'ah. And subhanallah, I have mentioned once, but I want to mention one more time, in order that we contemplate and we reflect in our salah, that how Allah Azza wa Jal has made from the standing up, that position, then the opening dua, and then the isti'ala, and then the bismillah, and then the surah al-fatiha, recitation of Quran, ruku', sujood, coming back from ruku and then sujood beautifully and ending up with two sajdas. It's only rukun that is more than the others. Two sajdas, not two rukus, only two sajdas. Telling us that sujood is the most important thing in salah. And that's the place where we're closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your body should make sajda to Allah azza wa jal, and before that, your heart should make sense to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, humbling yourself and putting your highest thing and the most honored thing in your body, that is your forehead, that you don't bow to anybody except to Allah azza wa jalla, you put it on the ground. And there Allah azza wa jalla yaftahu alayk, Allah azza wa jalla gives you the barakat, the blessings, the response to your dua. When you do that, you are humbling yourself. فَاعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثَرَةِ السُّجُودِ كَمَا قَالَ رَسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ رَبِيعَةَ ابْنُ كَعْبٍ الْأَسْلَمِ, when he said, help me against yourself with a lot of sujood, meaning a lot of Quran, I'm sorry, a lot of salah, because the sajda, you're not going to do only sajdas without salah prayer, but the sajda is the most important pillar that you do it in salah. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal legislated shara'a lana two sajdas in every rak'ah. And as we said, we should do every single pillar calmly and having a rest, pausing. Not just saying subhanallah, 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 right away. Actually, when I see some brothers, I don't know, does he say subhanallah 3 times or not? Maybe he once said once, alhamdulillah, he said once, but I don't know what you feel that subhanallah. We just hear that scene and that's it. I don't know what he said. Say that subhana rabbi al-a'la. You feel it and you mean it. Subhana, glorified be rabbi, my lord, al-a'la, oh Allah. I'm putting my forehead in the ground for you, that you are the a'la. You remind yourself that you are in this weakest position, down the ground to the one who is the highest. They above the heavens and the earth, subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhana rabbiya ta'ala. And you remind yourself, subbuhun, kuddusun, rabbul malaikati wa ruhi. You remind yourself of your situation and yourself and how you are in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we mentioned the sunnah of the Prophet between the two sajdas. Then if you go in the second rakah, they do the same, but just mention the sunnah of the Prophet that's called the jasad al-istiraha when you go to the second rakah, if you want to go to the second rakah. So you don't go right away, that's the sunnah of the Prophet, but you pause a little bit in the, you go in the second rakah, yes. So you just push with your fists on the ground, that's called jasad al-istiraha, or the sitting of istiraha. They're resting, you don't have to say stand or stay a lot, just a little bit to push your hands and your fists on the ground, and you go back and then position the second rakah. I start in the second rakah doing the same that you did in the first rakah, except dua al-istiftah. The opening dua you don't say in the second rakah, you say only in the first rakah as the sunnah. Then we pretend that we finished the second rakah. We finish the second rakah, we've said that everything, and we sit for the first tashahud, if it is Salat al-Dhuhr, or Maghrib, or Asr, or Isha. But the Fajr has only one tashahud, doesn't have so the first or the last of Fajr. For the this, you sit in. And then the sitting of the tashahud, it is the same like in between the two sessions, the first tashahud. Yes. You sit in the first tashahud, you're going to do it after that. The sitting for the tashahud at Awwal, and some they have said that it's sunnah, the sitting for the tashahud, and some they have said that it's wajib for that, this tashahud. As the Bukhari said, that tashahud at Awwal wajib, لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قام ركعتين ولم or باب that. باب من لم يرى التشهد الأول واجبا لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قام من ركعتين ولم يرجع. Some scholars have said the Imam Bukhari has said in his chapter in the Sahih Bukhari by saying this is a chapter of the for the opinion that some scholars don't see the tashahud, the first tashahud, as wajib, but it's a sunnah, because the Prophet one time he did not sit and he continued, he didn't come back to sit. And that means that if it was wajib, he had to come down and to make the tashahud. But if you're doing, that means that it's a sunnah. And in this case, for example, if a person forgets the tashahud in the awwal, this we have to explain this before we do that. So if the person, he is praying salah that has 3 rakah or 4 rakah, and he forgot to sit after the second rakah, if he is about to stand up, or in the middle of his way, just in the middle, he did not stand his back completely standing up, it is allowed for him to sit down, his mind, and do what he's doing with the tashahud. But he is completely standing up, then his mind, he thought, oh, I didn't do the tashahud. Then it is not allowed for him to sit down for the tashahud. It's not allowed. He should continue the salah. At the end, he does sujood sahu or sajda of forgetfulness and give salam, and inshallah, there is nothing in it. But if he was reminded and then he sits down, some people say his salah is sometimes accepted, his bath or something. But that's not the case. If he didn't know, alhamdulillah, Allah forgives the sins. He didn't know for that. But we need to understand that if you are standing up completely after you forgot the tashahud, you should not sit. Sometimes that happens with the imam. Like the imam, he knows that some brothers, they say, subhanallah, subhanallah, the imam doesn't sit. Subhanallah, they continue to say the imam. That happened many times to some imam, for example. So, because they think the imam has to come down. But as we said, if you completely straighten up your back and you stand up, it's not allowed to come down anymore by due to shahud. If you are in the middle of your way, just by going up and you come down, alhamdulillah, that's should be the case, inshallah. So the jasal tashahud, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to put his right hand on the right thigh and the left hand on the left thigh in this sitting. And the sunnah of the Prophet says from the beginning of the tashahud till the end of the tashahud, that he used to keep his index finger pointing out, and his middle finger and his thumb together like this, making a circle like the five in Arabic. That's the number five in Arabic. So make a circle, and sometimes he used to put the thumb in between this middle finger here, like this, or like this, in the index finger. That's a hadith sahih from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. يجلس مفترشا فخذه اليسرى إذا كانت الصلاة ركعتين كالفجر وقد أمر به المسلم صلاة فقال له فإذا جلست في وسط الصلاة فاطمئن وافترش فخذك اليسرى ثم تشهد. Can you please turn? And you sit, as we said, on the left foot and do the same that you do between the two sittings. Now I can turn. That's the sitting of the first tashahhud. وينبغي وضع الكف اليمنى على الفخذ اليمنى والكف اليسرى على الفخذ اليسرى. You say the right palm on the right thigh and the left palm on the left thigh. And they used to as the brother was showing, that you recite the tashahhud, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam يقبض أصابع الكف اليمنى كلها. Keeps the right, all the fingers of the left, of the right hand, and keeps in this way. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم يشير بإصبعه, and he used to point out and to move a little bit, to move it a little bit. يدعو بها كما في حديث واحد بن حجر. Hadith authentic from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, from narrated from واحد بن حجر رضي الله عنه. ثم رفع إصبعه, his finger, index finger, and I saw that he used to move a little bit. يدعو بها, make dua. Anytime you have dua in the tashahhud, you move it a little bit. Like for example, we start at tahiyyatul lillahi wa salawatul tayyibat. Here, you just point it out and then you start the dua. Salli ala Muhammadin wa Muhammad. That's what you do. That actually, some people, they only raise the finger while it is the time of the testimonial faith. Actually, testimonial faith is not dua. So in this case, you shouldn't move it. You just keep the finger like it is, because it's not dua. You just be a witness that Allah is the only God to be worshipped, and the Prophet Muhammad is his daily messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the rest, most of it is all dua. Salawat upon the Prophet. Anything you do is all dua. The first tashahhud, you recite the attahiyyat plus the salawat al-Ibrahimiyya. It's not only the tahiyyat. Many people recite only the tahiyyat. You know the tahiyyat. But it should be recited, because the tahiyyat comes always with salawat al-Ibrahimiyya. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. All the salawat al-Ibrahimiyya recited with the tahiyyat. This is in the first tashahhud. In the first tashahhud, you recite all of these. Then, if you go into the third rak'ah, as we said, the sunnah of the Prophet that he did with just the istiraha, the same, and we have raising as Allah Akbar, then you have raising of the hands while you're going, raising of the hands, as we said, the third rak'ah, or sometimes the Prophet used to do it while in the sajda. I'm sorry, while in the sitting, the shahud. Raising his hands, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahu Akbar,
Allahu Akbar.
And raise hands for the third rak'ah. So you continue the third and the fourth rak'ah. Now you are in the fourth rak'ah. In the fourth rak'ah, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was to sit jalsatul tawarruk. It's called at-tawarruk. So instead of sitting on the left foot, you sit on the ground. Instead of sitting on the left foot, you sit on the ground and put the left foot under the right foot. Okay? This is a sunnah. Doesn't mean that the one who doesn't do it, Salah is haram, astaghfirullah. But they're saying this is a sunnah, the Prophet used to do it. The third rak'ah of the Maghrib, because it is the last rak'ah. And the fourth rak'ah of Salat al-Asr, Dhuhr, and Isha. And sometimes he used to make the right left hand, no, this one, flat. This one, flat. So not directing, flat. Just like not putting the toes directly in the ground. So most of the times he said tawarruk. Always in the last rak'ah, the Prophet used to sit like that. Some people say, I cannot do that yet. Try to do it. If you do it, alhamdulillah, if you do it, at least Allah will give the reward of trying or that. And this is the way of sitting. You can turn.
So everybody,
maybe one thing can do one thing.
Yeah, we'll do it then.
No, we have the video.
So we are now in the last rak'ah, in the third of the Maghrib or fourth of other salawat. And you do the same that you do as the first tashahud, very exciting. At-tahiyyat, at-tahiyyat al-Nabi salawat al-Tahiyyat, you know what tashahud. And then salawat al-Ibrahimiyyah, and you keep moving a little bit the finger. Okay, some people they don't move at all. Some people they keep it straight. Some people they do up and down, up and down. No, that's not from the sunnah of the Prophet. Up and down, up and down. And actually, you distract some other people. They get bothered. What are you doing up and down? Some people they just doing like shaking, like that, just a little bit. And even if somebody can look from far away, he doesn't look at his moving. Just a little bit, like this. And you imagine that really this, as Imam Ahmad he said, it is heart of the shaitan that hit him with a steel, with a hadith or iron. It's heart of the shaitan because it's a sign of oneness of Allah Azza wa Jalla, Tawheed. And we're not doing because we like to bear ourselves, but we're doing because we want to follow the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, our beloved Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in order to get the reward. Yad'u biha. As long as the Imam is making dua, because sometimes the Imam is prolonged, you finish your duas. Should you stop doing that? Don't stop doing dua. Any dua you can do, Allah Azza wa Jalla will accept inshallah special. So after finishing the salawat al-Ibrahimiyyah, after the tahiyyat, the tashahud or the tahiyyat, finish salawat al-Ibrahimiyyah, should be recited that dua that the Prophet actually made wajib for us, that is the dua al-isti'adha from four things. To ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to seek refuge, protection from four things. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min 'adhabi al-qabr wa 'adhabi jahannam wa fitnati al-mahya wa al-mamat wa min sharri fitnati al-masih ad-dajjal. This is one of the du'as that we ask protection from the punishment of the grave, the punishment in the hellfire, and the fitna or the trial of death, life and death, and the evil of the trial of the dajjal. This du'a should be done at the end of the fourth or third tashahud. So in the third or fourth rak'ah, and the second tashahud or last tashahud you say. And after this you can do any du'a that you want. Actually, because this is a place on Allah, another place that Allah accepts a du'a. Any du'a. You have other du'as too in the Husn Muslim, the fortification of Muslim is a beautiful book, and you have a lot of du'as as the Prophet used to do, and that's the best. If you don't know those du'as, you can do any du'a you want. If especially the Imam, when you're praying with the Imam gives you time, if you're praying by yourself, do whatever du'a you want, and Allah Azza will accept it, because it's the time for exception of the du'as. And until the Imam gives salam, you continue do du'a for yourself and for all the Muslims and Muslimat. Allahumma. Then
For example, some of the du'as, like we said before the finish it, Allah ma'inni a'udhu bika min adhab al-qabr, as you said, a'udhu bika min adhab al-fitan al-masih al-dajjal, a'udhu bika min fitan al-mahya al-mamat, replace me. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-mathal wal-badr, or Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min sharri ma'amilt, wa min sharri ma'lam a'mal. Then, Allahumma hasibni hisaban yaseera. Allahumma hasibni hisaban yaseera. Or Allahumma inni dhalamtu nafsi dhulman kathira, wa la yaghfiru dhunuba illa ant, faghfirli maghfiratan min indik, wa rahamni innaka antal ghafurur rahim. Many of those du'as the Prophet used, that are at least nine of these du'as that the Prophet used. Then we come to the ending of the Salah, that is the Tasneem. As the Prophet said, مفتاح الصلاة الطهور وتحريمها التكبير وتحليلها التسليم. The key for the Salah, the opening of the Salah, is the طهور, the wudu, and تحريمها, meaning that you start the Salah and everything else, or things become something prohibited in Salah with the takbir of the ihram, that's what it's called, and وتحليلها التسليم, and things are allowed that you are finishing the Salah, it is, the key for that is the تسليم, giving the Salah. And we have mentioned that before, there are four ways of giving salam, authentic from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The world, most well known, the salam that he used to give on the right, salamu alaykum rahmatullah, on the left, salamu alaykum rahmatullah. You can show it. Looking on the shoulders. Some people, they just look far away. You should look on the shoulders. Just look at assalamu alaykum rahmatullah. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Looking on the shoulders only. Sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ahyan yazidu fil ula, the first, we used to add wa barakatuh. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This hadith sahih from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Abu Dawud. Sayyid al-Sahih. You see? As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And the left side, as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi. Same like it was. Because we should know that تسليمة الأولى واجب ركن. The first تسليمة on the right, it is a ركن, a pillar of the salah. The second تسليمة on the left, it is sunnah, it is not wajib. So it is this one on the right is wajib or form that should be done, and a ركن from the salah, but the second no. وكان أحيانا إذا قال عن يميني السلام عليكم ورحمة الله اقتصر أحيانا على قوله عن يساري السلام عليكم. Sometimes when he said السلام عليكم ورحمة الله on the right, sometimes he used to say السلام عليكم only, not ورحمة الله on the left, only السلام عليكم. So السلام عليكم ورحمة الله, السلام عليكم كشوم. This is hadith sahih in Sunan al-Nasa'i rahmatullahi alayhi. Wa kana ahyana sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to just say once assalamu alaykum in the middle, not in the right, but a little bit inclining to the right, assalamu alaykum, like that. Sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to do that sometimes, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Tilqa'a aw kana yusallimu taslimatan wahida, assalamu alaykum tilqa'a wajhi yaminu ila ash-shaqq al-aymani shay'an aw qalilan. Yani in front, just a little bit, assalamu alaykum. Only one. Wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This hadith is in at-Tirmidhi, hadithun sahih. Assalamu alaykum. These are all sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but as we said, the well-known is that he used to use most of the times. The others, we do it once in a time, once a week, once a month, whatever, at least that's because you do it because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it. That's why you want to do it, because you want to copy the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to get the reward from the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this is that some people, they think that there is a way of praying for men and there is a way of praying for women, and that's not true, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli, pray as you see me pray. And there is no authentic report that the Prophet prayed one time for the men and time for the women differently. There is no authentic report for that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, "Al-nisa'u shaqa'iqu al-rijal." The women are sisters of the brothers, meaning that they have the same, except something that when it came the evidences for something different in it. But what about the prayer, Hajj, Umrah, for some different things like this? Yes, but there is no evidence for anything for that, or difference for that. One time, Ibrahim al-Nakhai, rahmatullahi, one of the scholars from the Tabi'in, he said, تفعل المرأة في الصلاة كما يفعل الرجل. The woman in salah or does whatever the man does, the same thing. وروى البخاري في التاريخ الصغير بسند صحيح عن أم الدرداء البخاري رحمه الله. He not in صحيح in his صحيح but in التاريخ الصغير, that is another book of Bukhari رحمه الله عليه. He narrates by Umm al-Darda رضي الله عنه أنها كانت تجلس في صلاتها جلسة الرجل وكانت فقيها. That she used to sit in the salah like the man used to sit, and she was a scholar, فقيها رحم الله نساء المؤمنين. They were like Aisha رضي الله عنها, the best of the fuqaha, the best of the scholars, women scholars, was who? Aisha رضي الله عنها. رضي الله عنها, that some people, some people, filthy, really, they call her by names, and they make her as she is not from Muslims anymore. They make her kafir, like the Shia. They call her kafir, the rawafid. Aisha radiallahu anha, she was the faqih of this ummah. She was faqih. She was a great scholar. She is the one who stayed with the promises the most, and she narrated from the Prophet from the women. She's the one who narrated most of the hadith of the Prophet from the women, and Abu Hurairah from the men. She would stick to the Prophet, she knew the details of life of the Prophet. After Aisha, there are a lot of scholars. Imam Ahmad, rahmatullah alayhi, Imam Ahmad, you can imagine, he had more than 300 women scholars. Sheikha. It doesn't mean that he went to the Sheikha and Sheikha is sitting there in front of and the people and the men are taking knowledge from that. No, there were other guys and behind the curtain or anything, how they used to take the lesson from them. But I mean that even the women, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on them, they were a lot of scholars among them. So Umm Darda radiallahu anha was from the Sahabiyat radiallahu anha. So, in this way, we completed almost, or said that the Salah, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to pray, we're going to make a
full Salah, inshallah, full rak'ah, and
demonstrating.
You take the mic. Right
there.
And then he recites with the Fatiha by saying, "I will be glad in Shaddai." I will talk. You just so Subhanallah, we have to be Tabarak al-Sultan al-Mulad al-Maluk al-Bab Sattah. Then I will be glad in Sami'il Alim in Shaitan al-Rajim in Hamzi Yunafi Yunafi, or I will be glad in Shaitan al-Rajim in Hamzi Yunafi Yunafi, or I will be glad in Shaitan al-Rajim. Then Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Then Surah al-Fatiha. Then short Surah al-Qur'an. And or any sort of Quran, you know. Then we go to the rukua by saying Allahu Akbar. Grasping the hands and the knees. Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Rabbana wa laka al-hamd, hamdan katheeran tayyiban mubarakan fihi, wa laka al-dhikr kama yuhibbu rabbuna wa yardha. Then we go in the sajda by putting the right, saying Allahu Akbar. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Allahu Akbar. Rabbi al-Fili, Rabbi al-Fili, Rabbi al-Fili, or other words. Allahu Akbar. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Allahu Akbar. We go in the second Raka. As we do the same, pretend we are now in the second, the after we finish the second rakah, because we never do this. And you are sitting just at the tashahhud. We recite the tahiyyat, so we know, and the salawat of Ibrahimiyya, if it is the first tashahhud. If it is the second, we're not going to do the fourth rakah. If it is the second, we recite the du'a of isti'ada from Allah al-Qabr, Allah al-Jahannam, and others, and any other du'a. And we ask any du'a to Allah subhanahu, and then we give the salam in the right. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. And we mentioned there are some words, as-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, on the right. On the left, as-salamu alaykum. And the fourth one, just keep your incline a little bit from the right. As-salamu alaykum. And the four ways. Okay. Now just, I'm going to go over 14 pillars of salah. So we need to know what is the pillar of salah. First, the first pillar of salah is Al-Qiyam, standing up. You have to stand up for the one who is in. Second pillar of Salah, pillar means that, like the building has the pillars, if any of those pillars is not there, the Salah is void. The first, standing up. The second is Takbiratul Ihram. The first Takbir. The third is recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha, it's the book. The fourth is Al-Ruku'ah. Al-Ruku'ah. Just the ruku'ah. The fifth is standing up from the ruku'ah and straighten back your back in a standing position. Then the sixth is at the sujood, first sajda. Then the seventh, coming back, raising your head from the sujood. That's a pillar, raising your head from the sujood. The eighth, sitting in between two sajdas, and just to be as the thing, is the pillar. Ninth, the other sajda. The other seven. Then the tashahhud al-akhir, the last tashahhud. The sitting for the last tashahhud is one pillar. Then reciting the tashahhud is another. So sitting, just sitting for the last tashahhud is a pillar. And reciting the tashahhud, tahiyyat, and salawat al-Ibrahimiyya is the other pillar. Then the other pillar is at-taslim. Taslim. Or salam. And the other pillar is calmness that you have to have in all these pillars we mentioned. Calmness and resting and posing, but not doing fast all these pillars that we just mentioned. These are the pillars of the salam. If any of those pillars is not there, the salam is considered void and does not count. Understood, inshallah? These are the pillars of the salam. And wajibat as sunnah, the saying, these words are two more than this, but we just mentioned this, at least the pillars of the salah that are most important things in our salah. I think it's enough for this.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Two questions. How many times to say Rabbighfirli.
There are narrations two or three. But the best is to say other du'as. I mean, to add more. Rabbighfirli warhamni wahdini warzuqni warzuqni. Because you are asking Allah for more. But you can, there are narrations of two.
And the other question is, when sitting for the at-tahiyyat in the first time.
So first
tashahud,
yes.
First tashahud. So after tashahud, you said like.
You have to recite the salawat al-Ibrahim.
Yes. Is there any evidence for that or?
There's yes, there's evidence for that because Salawat al-Ibrahimiyya they were always with the tashahud. When the hadith of the Prophet it came always the salawat connected to the tahiyyat, not the tashahud. The tahiyyat al-Ibrahim salawat al-Ibrahim. I passed the proof because I didn't want to make it longer. Yes, the salat, as you said. فكان صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي على نفسه في التشهد الأول وغيره. حديث أن أبو عوانة في صحيح والنسائي used to pray to make salawat upon himself in the first تشهد and the other تشهد. So he used to do it in the first تشهد too. That's a hadith صحيح authentic from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
That's what he used to do regularly, or
yes, just we said used to do it. Oh yes, always. Maybe the first tashahud.
Most of the people
they don't do it. They do only the tahiyyat. They do only the tahiyyat. That
because I'm asking this is the first time I heard from you, and you know, so for whatever the lecture I had. Like no one mentioned this.
I understand. I said there are different opinions for scholars for this.
I heard before.
But the most correct opinion for the evidence is no. Alhamdulillah, in fiqh Islam there are a lot of opinions because it depends how the scholar understood the proof. Or sometimes he doesn't see the evidence authentic or it depends. In the sense, but we are. Teaching the one that we think that is most correct because of the evidences that we have seen from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَالتَّشَهُدْ عَلَى الصَّلَاةُ وَالصَّلَاةُ عَلَى النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم التَّشَهُدْ الْأَوَّلِ بِكُلِّ رَكَعَ غَيْرُ الصُّبْحِ تَشْهَدَانِ التَّشَهُدْ الْأَوَّلِ التَّشَهُدْ الْأَخِرِ إِنْ تَرَكَ التَّشَهُدْ الْأَوَّلِ وَالصَّلَاةُ عَلَى النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم الْأَوَّلِ سَاهِرٌ لَا إِعَادَةَ عَلَيْهِ. As we said, if you forget, even if you forget if you forget the first tashahud, even the first tashahud is not wajib by itself. So how can be? You understand? How if the first tashahud is not wajib in itself, that if you forget it, you don't have to repeat. So the same thing, the salawat upon the Prophet that are part of the tashahud should not be like the second one that is full, that is a rukn. As we said, that's a rukn and wajib. But the Prophet used to say it. Well, he said, well, I forget, he used to say that the tashahud has been, this hadith has been mentioned. That's why the scholars, any hadith, we should work with it. And there is no evidence that the Prophet contradict this hadith that we mentioned. That, كان يصلي على نفسه التشهد الأول وغيره. He used to think salawat upon himself in the first tashahud and right in Arabic, not كان, he used to. When you say used to, and it means that he did it more than once, he did it many times, okay? We're not going to fight with one another, okay, he did it or not, let's say that he did it sometimes and sometimes he didn't do it. What's going to prevent you from doing it? Do it, alhamdulillah, you get more reward for doing it, even if we say like this. So, but we say that he used to do it, son of Allah, so we do it. Yeah. Is
it right? My question is about the recitation of the Surah Fatiha behind the Imam.
Yes.
So when is the time to recite that Surah Fatiha?
As we said, there are two opinions of the scholars. That when the Imam is reciting loudly, if the Imam is reciting, you're not allowed to recite, even Surah Al-Fatiha. Because, as we said, Surah Al-Fatiha is a rukun. But the scholars have said, one group of the scholars have said that because the Imam is reciting, in this case, it's okay if you don't recite. Because he's reciting loud. Because there is a hadith the Prophet said, قِرَاءَةُ الْإِمَامِ قِرَاءَةٌ لِمَنْ يَأْتِمُ بِهِ وَرَى. The recitation of the Imam is the recitation for the one who is praying with him. That doesn't mean what the Imam is reciting that has been misunderstood. What the Imam is reciting silently and you should not recite. No, you should recite. But at least this is one opinion. Another opinion is that some scholars, Imam al-Bukhari or someone mentioned, some scholars, they have that even if the Imam is reciting, you have to recite. You have to find the time. Maybe the Imam gives you some time. Or if he doesn't give it you, you can find, or when the Imam stops, you can find, you can say, like, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Some people, they do like that. But for myself, that's a little bit of distracting. Because you will not focus. You will not focus on what recitation is doing. You want to rush and to do that. So if the Imam gives you time, alhamdulillah, it doesn't give you, alhamdulillah, inshallah, has accepted that is the recitation of the Imam, so the fact only.
Sometimes some Imams give some time.
Okay, now for that, sometimes gives, I don't give. Why I don't give? Because it's not from the Sunnah. It's not from the Sunnah to give time, actually. There is no narration from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he used to pause or to stop after reciting Surah Al-Fatiha by saying Ameen. And then he used to recite right away, just maybe taking the breath, but he used to start the Surah after Surah Al-Fatiha, any Surah after Surah Al-Fatiha. Used not to pause. Some people, they give. But this kind of, so if you pray behind an Imam that gives, you have time to recite from another Alhamdulillah. But for myself, for example, I don't do it because it's not from the Sunnah, but not because I don't have mercy on you to say Surah Fatiha, but that's why I don't do it, for example. So Alhamdulillah, inshallah, has accepted what the Imam recites.
But you can do this ayah, like when you are stopping? Like...
If you can do that, you can, because it's given the time, you can do that. So you have the opinion that you have to recite. But the most important is the attention to reflect, especially. We need to know, at least, if we don't understand Arabic, we need to know what's the meaning of the Surah Al-Fatiha, to live with the Surah Al-Fatiha. The problem is that we want to push on Salah, and some of us, the Surah Al-Fatiha is done, and we start to have Kushur, or we want to have Kushur in Salah. If the Surah Al-Fatiha is done, that's the core, that there is no Surah that has been revealed from Allah Azza wa Jalla better than Surah Al-Fatiha. In all the books of Allah, Quran, Allah, Injil, Zabur, all the books of Allah, Surah Al-Fatiha is the best of the surahs. Is the meaning, the essential of the core essence of all the meanings of all the books. It is the Surah Al-Fatiha.
Okay, that's good.
When do you do it?
Yes. Then you could just wait until the Imam, or as soon as the Imam says Assalamu alaikum, you can do it right away with the Imam. I mean after the Imam, because some people they say before that's wrong, and anything you do, you should do it after the Imam. Or you just wait a little bit, like the Imam, he almost is finishing. Right, and you start saying, but the best is, as everything, to not delay. Like, do not delay. Right after Imam starts saying something, you start doing. The same thing is for all the arkan salah. Because delaying, that as saying that you are not allowed to proceed or to do it before the Imam, the same thing, you should not do it to delay it a long time after the Imam. Like, for example, people are in Rukua, or in the center, and the brother is still there waiting. Or you miss, if you miss, actually by saying, you miss two ruknas. Two ruknas. For example, you are still in ruku and the people are in sajda. One rukn, standing up after ruku, and another rukn, that is sajda. That's, they can say that your salah is not sajda like that. You should right away after the imam. And another thing, because this is in, when you pray your salah by yourself. I want to mention something because there are many mistakes that people do while they are praying with the imam. I have mentioned many times, but just to remind us that one thing is that when the imam is going to the sajda, nobody should bend his back until the imam puts his forehead on the sajda. When you say Allahu Akbar, he comes to the sajda, you wait. Even don't bend your back to do the sajda unless you see the imam that he put the forehead in the sujood. Because the hadith Sahih Bukhari and the Sahaba narrate that there was no one bending their back, meaning they did not start unless they see the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam put the forehead on the sajda. Yes.
Brother, as you said, like, until you see Imam is...
No, it doesn't mean that you see. I mean, especially the first... Now,
because
you just...
people from the...
Those who don't see, the first time you were praying in one line, whatever you pray. Yeah, you can just try to measure that time, how many seconds it takes for the Imam to go to the... And usually, what the Imams do, they prolong the takbir, we're saying Allahu Akbar. Once almost the Allahu Akbar is almost done, they are... back and on the sajda. So just keep like you give that how many seconds you give, and then you go. So it's a basra because some people they do it very fast. Yeah. Not the imam.
Sometimes imam is too fast. We cannot complete the. It's a Zuhud Ibrahim. So what can we do? We should be complete.
Yeah, you should complete this.
Because imam is very fast. He says, Assalamu alaikum.
So before
you complete the
last mashal with me,
yes. Before you complete the
like two
Ibrahim, so you say Assalamu alaikum.
You complete your stuff so by yourself. So it's okay here. Yeah, you're complete, but try to do it a little bit faster, not fast, but a little bit faster to reach the imam. If the imam is not like really fast. And you do that, but you have to complete by yourself. I mean, the Salawat al-Ibrahim.
In two rakas, sometimes, you say we have to read the Durd Ibrahim.
Yes.
So some, they only.
If they don't give you time, as you don't give yourself, it's not. If the Shahud is not wajib, so what about the Salawat al-Ibrahim? It's not wajib. And it's not recommended to complete it for them. But if you do it, if you can, come to that.
So prolonging the shahad, is that okay after the imam? Like if you just continue the dua along with the
imam? No. The dua that is required. He's saying that that the imam did it fast. So he didn't give time to mu'min to finish what is required. Like Allahumma salli ala nabiyyina Muhammad. But it usually doesn't happen. Maybe it's too so fast. So you just finish that a little bit. It's not too much, but because you have to finish this, it's a requirement. But I'm not saying that imam is finishing. It's finished, and you are continue doing du'a by yourself. No. Because you have to. Follow the imam.
You pray after Abu Sa'ad, you have time.
It is.
If we make don't see on the first tashahhud, do you have to do?
Yes, I mentioned that. If you, in the first tashahhud you forgot to sit, you have to do sajdatu sahwi or sajdatu forgetfulness. How you do it? Salam progress in this case because you forgot something. Then before you give salam, you do two sentences, one sentence, and then another sentence, and then you don't recite the tahiyat after that. One more time, and give salam on the right and the left because you forgot. Yeah.
do the second.
And that is the can you do of the dua?
Can you do the
dua?
No, not dua, nothing. Well, he says that, yes. The dua that you do, anything. Subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No, other dua. Any other dua.
This, I never heard anything, any special about that sajda. It's no masajda. No masajda. Well, usually, no, because that sajda, the sajda before you did the dua, you just only this dua, normal sajda, yes. All the brothers? No, two persons from one family?
This relate with this question. Because otherwise, it's not going to be finished.
Okay.
Let's say you forgot to make sahu sajud.
Okay, the forget to make salam. Now, they say the scholars, la sahu ala sahu. There is no sajda of forgetfulness for the forgetting a sajda of forgetfulness. There is no, khalas, it's done. You forgot. Allah Azza wa Jalla will not take you. You forgot to make sajda of forgetfulness.
Yeah, after you make it the slim, then you remember, I'm supposed to give to...
After you make it the slim, you were reminded that you forgot the tashahud.
Yeah.
Okay, tashahud. Mm-hmm. Then you can
yeah.
Okay. Just make two sentences, right? With only two sentences and give salam. Yes.
Okay. I'm done for today.
Yes.
Can you make dua other than Arabic?
Okay. Now we're saying if you don't know, like you left Allah Azza wa Jalla wasaha, if Allah Azza wa Jalla doesn't bear or burden a person more than he can and he's able to. If you don't know, you are struggling and to learn this dua in Arabic, and you don't know anything, you can make dua, inshallah. That's anything that you can do in secondary. You mean in sajda? Dua in sajda. Yeah, in sajda. Yes, especially in sunnah in nafil, yes, you can do dua. It's allowed if not anybody like you, especially in Muslims, they don't know anything else. And let them make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, because it's still dua, even if it's in Arabic, because he doesn't know. If he knows and he can learn something, alhamdulillah. But if he cannot, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin, especially. But especially in Sunnah, yes. In fard, you can do it, and if you don't know anything. As, especially for recitation of Quran, you can do this dua in Arabic. People, they can learn it, but people, they cannot learn anything. Alhamdulillah, Allah, that should not be a case that Allah Azza wa Jalla accepts in any language dua. So there is nothing inshallah.
When you make
it,
when you make sujood, your toes should be facing qibla or against
your toes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Fingers.
If you don't do it, like would that be like your toes?
No, it doesn't break. That doesn't break. That doesn't break the salah. Yeah. But the sunnah, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, meaning when you say the sunnah. That was the way the Prophet used to pray. And what I need to make it clear that the way that we present it is that what the hadith tells us the Prophet used to pray. And some things are wajib that should be, and some things are sunnahs, like the Prophet used to do it. But if the person doesn't do it that way, doesn't mean that this salah is not accepted. But you want to do it the best way to perfect it as the Prophet did. Some things, if you don't do it, your salah is not accepted, really, some things, but not everything. So this is the way, like the person, for example, they said the toes, everything, your body should be facing the qibla, everything, with everything. Starting with your heart, your face, your toes, and your feet, and everything. Even like some people, when they pray, they keep their feet like this. Is this haram? I'm not saying it's haram, but is this the way? No, the way should be that your body should be standing and straight towards the qibla. Not like this, not like this, like V. There. while you're praying by yourself, and this is more when you pray in the line with the brother. So, and we need to explain other things with when you pray in Jama'ah, inshallah, next time, because of Allah. So, and the same thing with the toes, when you make the sajda, like you said, need to be together and in this position. Not like this. I'm not saying this is haram and your salah is not accepted. Okay? But the way the Prophet did is like this. Together. And the toes. Okay? We're showing the best way. The best way is the way the Prophet did it.
Friends, get together.
Yeah. No, that's another case.
Maybe next time we'll be questioning.
Yeah, maybe we can do it for the Salat of Jama'ah, inshallah. Okay. You have dinner, inshallah.